Polymorphism, as we already have discussed, is having more than one form. That is, you can define a function with the same name but having different parameter list. That is, so long as the function name remains the same, you can have different number or type or order of parameters. In such case, the resolution of which function to be executed is done at compile time. This is called compile time polymorphism, which is implemented using what we call function overloading. And the third principle of object-oriented programming is inheritance. And we'll first be looking at what is inheritance in this unit. Well, before we proceed further, I'll pose you a question as to who are you? Okay. Yes? Okay. You are student. Fair enough. Okay. Who am I? I am a professor. Okay. Am I a person? Yes. Are you a person? Yes. Okay. Both student and professor are basically persons. That means person has a name, so does a student. Person have age, so does a student. Person has probably email ID, phone number. All these are generic traits or generic characteristics of a student. And don't you think they apply to a professor as well? Don't you think they apply to another entity such as a doctor or a lawyer? Yes, the answer is yes. So, the name, date of birth, or age, phone number, email ID, these are common characteristics or common attributes that are shared by each of these different entities. Okay. If I want to define a student class as well as a professor class, do I have to declare data members such as name, age, email ID, mobile number in both the student class as well as in the professor class? That results in code redundancy, right? Okay, repeating the same set of code in one or more or two or more classes is unnecessary. Okay. Think of a scenario where I have a person class which already has defined attributes such as name, age, email ID, phone number. Okay, so these attributes or these data members have already been, assuming that these have already been defined in one of the classes such as person, then can I reuse these attributes as well as operations such as get details, which will read details of a person such as name, age, email ID and phone number is already defined in the person class, then can I reuse the attributes and operations or the data members and the functions that are defined in the person class by the student class and the professor class? That is, can I reuse the properties defined in one of the class by some other class? Okay. Now, how does a student as a person differ from a professor as a person? Okay. Student may have a specific attribute such as roll number. He may have a specific attribute such as CGPA. Whereas a professor may have a specific attribute such as employee ID. Or he may have a specific attribute such as salary. Okay. Student does not have an employee ID. Student does not have a salary. Professor doesn't have a roll number. Professor doesn't have a CGPA. Okay. Then what am I doing? I am reusing the attributes and operations of the person class in the student class and defining only those specific features that apply only to the student class inside the student class. Similarly, I will be reusing the attributes and operations available in a person class with the professor class. However, I'll be declaring those attributes that are specific to a professor class within this. This is the essence of inheritance. Inheritance in C++ allows us to derive the attributes and operations or data members and the member functions available in a base class by some other classes. Okay. So person here acts as the base class, and the student and the professor classes act as the derived classes. Okay. And you may also have observed here that base class defines the general characteristics such as name, age, email ID and phone number, which are common to all persons. So base class basically implements what we call generalization, whereas derived class defines its own specific attributes, its own specific characteristics. So derived classes implement what we call specialization. So inheritance is basically a generalization towards the specialization hierarchy, where the general class or the base class is derived by the subclasses. Okay. Now with this, what do we achieve? We achieve what we call reusability. That is, I don't have to declare all these attributes all over again in this class as well as in this class. I can just derive them from the base class called person. This results in reusability of code. I hope you understood the concept behind inheritance. Okay. So as I said, inheritance is one of the three fundamental principles of object-oriented programming. Inheritance allows hierarchical classification. What do we mean by hierarchical classification? We have a general class that captures the common traits of a set of entities. Student is an entity, professor is an entity, doctor is an entity, lawyer is an entity. So the base class or a general class captures those common traits or common characteristics related to a set of entities. That is called generalization. And this class in turn can be inherited by one or more specific classes, each adding their own specific features. Okay, that is roll number and CGPA by student class, or employee ID and salary by the professor class. This is what we call specialization. So it is basically generalization to specialization hierarchy that is implemented using inheritance. Okay, a class that is inherited, that is in this example, the person class is called the base class, or it is also sometimes called a super class or a parent class. And the class that does the inheritance, in this case student or the professor class, is called a derived class, which is also called a subclass or a child class. So super class or base class or parent class, all of these are synonyms. Similarly, subclass or derived class or child class are called synonyms. Okay. And as I also discussed, inheritance leads to one of the attractive features of programming called reusability. That is reusability, reusing the existing code is what we call reusability, which results in reduced effort on the part of the programmer, and reduced effort in turn results to improved productivity. Well, this is another example where I have vehicle as the generalization. All vehicles, okay, can be classified in turn into land vehicles, air vehicles or water vehicles. Land vehicles in turn can be classified as a bicycle or a car or a bus or a truck. Okay. Don't you think this is different from this, which in turn is different from this and this? Yes. Then this is what we call specialization. That is, a bicycle does not have a mileage, whereas car has a mileage. So mileage is a specific attribute or a data member of a class which may not be applicable for bicycle. However, all of them have wheels. So wheel can become a common attribute shared across all these attributes, all these subclasses. However, the number of wheels could be different. It could be 2 or 4 or 8. Okay. So from the generalization towards the specialization, we define specific attributes applicable only to those classes, and this hierarchical classification is what we call inheritance. Objects are often defined in terms of hierarchical classification with a base class and one or more levels of classes that inherit from the classes that are above it in the hierarchy. Okay. This example also demonstrates the same thing. Shape is a general class. All shapes have areas. All shapes have sides. However, depending on the nature of shape, we can classify it into a 2D shape or a 3D shape. Coming to 2D shape, I have circle, square, triangle. Okay. Square has 2 sides, or rather 4 sides, and triangle has 3 sides. Okay. Circle doesn't specifically have a side. So these are special or specific traits of these subclasses. And how you compute area of a square will be different from that of a triangle, which in turn is different from that of a circle. So you can define specific behavior within these classes. So just to summarize or to give you a gist as to what we have seen so far, as far as inheritance is concerned, inheritance is the capability of one class to acquire the properties and characteristics of another class. The another class in this case acts as the base class or the super class, and the class that inherits the properties and the characteristics of this class is called subclass or derived class. That is, the class whose properties are inherited by the other class is called the parent or the base class or the super class, and the class which inherits the properties of the other class is called child class or derived class or subclass. Inheritance makes the code reusable. When we inherit an existing class, all the methods and the fields or the functions and the data members within the base class will become available in the new class, that is student or professor. Hence, the code that is already available in the base class can easily be reused rather than having to rewrite it within these subclasses. Okay. I just said all the data members will be available to the new class. Does that mean the private members of the base class will become available to the subclass? The answer is no. Okay. That is the fundamental aspect of data hiding or encapsulation. Okay. When we make a data member private to a class, it remains private to the class. This is what we have seen in all classes. So, a member defined to be private, irrespective of whether it is a data member or a member function, remains private within that class. It cannot be accessed by anyone outside the class. If you want a member to be accessible outside the class, then you need to make it what? Public. You need to use the visibility specifier or the access modifier as public instead of private. In that case, the member becomes visible outside the class. Okay. Well, what is the syntax of implementing inheritance? Okay. This is very simple. Class is the keyword followed by subclass name. Colon is the operator that is used to implement inheritance, followed by access mode, followed by superclass name. That is, class, assume that I have a class A which has certain data members and member functions. and I want to inherit class A within some other class, let us say class B, then I have to say class B inherits access mode class A, and then you can have specific data members and the functions defined within class B. Okay, what is this access mode? Okay, the access mode can be either public or private, or there is one more modifier which we had introduced long time back. We will be discussing the meaning of this third access modifier in today's class. So the access mode can either be public or private or protected. What is the difference between specifying the mode as public or private or protected will become clear shortly. Okay, at this point, understand that class A becomes the base class and class B inherits class A using the mode of derivation as public. Now what happens? All the data members and the member functions will become available to class B. That is, class B can access the data members and the member functions available in the base class A. Okay, so we use the term that the data members and the member functions of the base class will be logically present in the derived class B. But of course, the data members and the functions that are private to class A will not be available to class B. Okay, that is obvious because all private members of a class remain private to that class. Okay, so the syntax is class keyword inheritance operator followed by access mode followed by base class name. Okay, and then any members that are specific to class B or any functions that are specific to class B can be implemented within class B. Okay, so while defining a subclass like this, obviously the superclass or the base class must have already been defined. Okay, or at least it should have been declared rather than defined before the subclass can be declared. Okay, access mode that can be used can either be public or private or protected, and the colon is used for inheriting the features of the base class into the derived class. This is the basic syntax of inheritance. Okay, this is exactly what I said earlier. Okay, class, person, data members and methods or functions specific to person class have been defined already, and employee is a person, so employee class employee colon public person, so class employee will inherit the data members and the methods available in the base class person. However, the subclass employee can define its own data members and member functions. Okay, that is what I was talking about. Person in this case becomes the base class and the employee becomes the derived class, and the data members and the methods available in the person class will automatically be logically present in the derived class employee. Okay, this is what we call inheritance. Okay, and the UML notation. Okay, remember what is UML? UML stands for Universal Modeling Language. Okay, UML notation for representing inheritance is base class, arrow that goes from the derived class towards the base class. So this is the derived class. An arrow pointing from the derived class towards the base class is the notation that we use to represent inheritance in UML. This is another example, okay, where I have base class shape. It has its own attributes and operations. Rectangle class inherits the shape class. However, it can define its own attributes and operations. However, the attributes and operations available in the base class will be available to the subclass. Similarly, there could be another class that could inherit the same base class shape. So all the attributes and operations of the base class will be automatically inherited by the subclass. However, the subclass circle can in turn define its own specific attributes and operations. Okay. So it is not mandatory that for a base class there can be only one subclass. You can have more than one subclass. Okay. How you organize it, how you organize the inheritance hierarchy leads to different types of inheritance. Okay. Different types of inheritance. We'll be looking at different types of inheritance. The first one is one class inherits another class. This is what we call single inheritance. Okay. I have a base class and one derived class inherits the base class. That is called single inheritance. Second, as we saw, shape, okay, or one base class is being inherited by an intermediate base class, which in turn is inherited by a subclass. This is called multi-level inheritance. We'll be looking at examples for each shortly. The third type of inheritance is hierarchical inheritance. Okay, the shape class was being inherited by both circle class as well as triangle class. This is an example of hierarchical classification where more than one subclass derives from a single base class. This is called hierarchical inheritance. The fourth form of inheritance or fourth type of inheritance is multiple inheritance. That is, more than one derived class inherits from more than one base class. Okay, so I have two base classes and one derived class. So this derived class inherits the properties of both this as well as this class. Okay, this is the fourth type of inheritance called multiple inheritance. And the fifth form of inheritance is a mixture of all these different types of inheritance, which is called hybrid inheritance. Okay, observe that till this point it is hierarchical inheritance. However, these two classes in turn are inherited by this class. This is an example of multiple inheritance. So you can have a mixture of one or more inheritance. That is the fifth type of inheritance called hybrid inheritance. Okay. Well, I just told that there are three modes of derivation. Three modes of derivation or three modes of inheritance. The first one I said public, second one is private, and the third one is protected. Let us look at each of them in detail. The first one is private inheritance. Here I have used the access mode or the mode of derivation as private. So class derived colon private base. And then members of the derived class can be defined within this. Okay. Let us look at an example. Class A. Let us assume that I have data member X. Okay. And class B uses private mode of derivation to inherit A. Will this member be derived by class B? No. Why not? Because X is a private member of class A. If you don't specify any access specifier, it by default is private, right? Remember that. So X is by default private. So all private members of class A remain private to that. Okay. What if this were public? Okay. If I have a public member in a base class, and if the mode of inheritance is private, then public members of the base class become private members of the derived class. Important point to note here. Okay. So it has its own data members. Okay. Let us assume that I have a data member called Y. Okay. Inside main, okay, I will instantiate an object of class B. B OBJ. OBJ is an object of class B. Can I say cout OBJ dot X? The answer is no. Why not? Because X, though is a public member, since the mode of derivation is private, X becomes a private member of class B. Whether a private member of class B can be accessed outside the class? No. Because private member of a class remains private to it, so X cannot be accessed using an object of class B. Okay. Can you access Y? Yes, definitely. Because Y is a public member of class B, I can always access Y using an object of class B. Perfect? Okay. This is the first mode of inheritance. Did you understand this? Okay. So when the base class is privately inherited by the derived class, that is, when the mode of derivation is private, public members of the base class become private members of the derived class. Okay. Second mode of inheritance is public. So I will replace this with public. What happens if the mode of derivation is public? That is, instead of private, I will use the mode of operation as mode of derivation as public. Then all the members of the base class will be derived by the subclass. But how are they derived? Okay. When the base class is publicly inherited, public members of the base class become public members of the derived class. However, private members of the base class remain private to the base class and will never become members of the derived class, obviously, because private means private, nothing. Okay. Only one person can access the private part. Only one person can access the private data members of a class. Who is that? A friend function. Okay. A friend function can always have access to the private members of a class. Except for a friend function, no one else can access the private members of a class. So if the base class contains private members, they don't become part of the derived class. Okay. Coming back here, okay. Can I access X using an object of class B? The answer is yes. Why? Because X is a public member of class A, and class B derives A using public mode of derivation. So X becomes a public member of class B also. Since X is a public member of class B, using an object of class B, I can access X. Can I access Y? Yes, you can, because Y is a public member of class B. You can access Y via an object of class B, definitely. What if I have a private member, say Z? Can I access Z using OBJ? The answer is no, because Z is a private member of class A. Even though the mode of derivation is public, private member of base class remains private to the base class. It won't be derived by the subclass. So Z will not be accessible to class B. So an object of class B cannot have access to Z. Simple as that. Okay. Similarly, what if I have a private member, say, int E? Okay. Can I access D using OBJ? The answer is no again, because D is a private member of class B. So B remains private to B. So you cannot access D using an object of class B. Hope I made myself clear. It is clear to all of you. Okay. So this is the second mode of derivation. First one was private and the second one is public. We'll be looking at the third mode of protected shortly. Okay. Let us look at an example of single inheritance. Okay. I have account class as a base class and programmer class inherits account class using public mode of derivation. Okay. Account class has a data member salary and programmer class introduces a data member called bonus. Inside main, I instantiate an object of programmer class and then I am displaying the salary, that is p1.salary, which will be 60,000, and p1.bonus, which will be 50,000. I can access salary because salary is a public member and the derivation is public. And I can access bonus because bonus is a public member of class B or class programmer. Let us look at another example. Okay. Class B has one data member and one private data A, one public data member B, and three member functions, set AB, which will initialize values to the members, get A, returns the value contained in A. Why do I have get A? Because private data member, I cannot directly access the value contained in A outside the class. So whenever I have to deal with private data members, I need to make use of what are called getters and setters. That is, to assign values, I will use setters. That is, for example, set A. And in order to assign a value to a private member, I will use set A as a function. And in order to get the value contained in a private member, I use get A. So these are called getters and setters, which we already have seen during our earlier classes. Okay. Class B inherits, class D inherits B publicly, and it introduces its own private member called C, and then two member functions, mul, which will multiply B and A to assign a value to C, and one more function which will display the values in A, B, and C. You can visualize this single inheritance as this. Okay. Class D has its own private data member C, however, and it has its own member functions mul and display. However, it inherits B, it inherits set AB, it inherits get A and show A from the base class B. Observe that class D doesn't inherit A from class B because A is a private data member of class B. Is that clear? This is how the single inheritance works. Okay. So inside main, I will instantiate an object of class D and D dot set AB. Okay. So using an object of derived class, I am invoking the function contained in the base class because this function contained in the base class is available to class D because class D inherits from class B. Similarly, mul, which is a member function of class D, which can be directly executed, show A contained in base class, display contained in the subclass. I can assign a value to B because B is a public member of the base class and it is publicly derived. I can invoke D dot mul display. Okay, all these things can be performed. Did you understand how single inheritance works? Okay, coming to how do we make a private member inheritable? Okay, that is, a private member of a class. But we just said No one else can access the private members except for a then what is the other than friend? Because I don't want to use friend functions. I want the inherited class or I want the derived class to access the private members of the base class. By making the members of a class protected, I can make them, then private members cannot be accessed outside the class. Similarly, protected members cannot be accessed outside the class except for the derived class. Okay? Only derived class has access to the protected members. Else can have the access to protected members of the base class. That is as good as securing your base class. Okay. So C++ provides a third visibility modifier called protected, which serves a limited purpose inheritance. What does that mean? A member declared as protected is accessible by the member functions within its class and any classes that are derived from it. Okay? So the protected members of a class will be visible only to the derived classes, no one else. Okay. It cannot be accessed by the functions outside these two classes. Okay. That is exactly same as a private member. Private member cannot be accessed by anyone outside the class except for friends. Protected members of a class cannot be accessed by anyone that derives from that. A protected member of the base class is inherited in private mode, becomes private in the derived class. It is not available for further inheritance since private members cannot be inherited. Okay. Did you understand that last point? Okay. For example, if I make this protected, and I make X to be protected, then a protected member of the base class inherited in private mode, becomes private member of class B. Okay? What does that mean? X is a protected member of base class A and mode of inheritance is private. So what happens to X? X becomes a private member of class B. So I cannot access X using an object of class B. Okay. What if this is public? Will the protected member become public member of class B? No. Okay. Protected member of class A becomes a protected member of class P even though you have used the mode of derivation as public. Okay, understand that. Okay. A, B. Okay. If you make this private, then X becomes private to B. If someone else derives B, then does the derived class C get access to X? No, because X has become private member of class B. What if I make it public? I just said X becomes a protected member, or rather X remains a protected member. So C again derives the member contained in class B as well as class E. That is, this summary will tell you clearly as to what exactly happens. Okay. See, if the base class members, data members or member functions, if the access specifier is private and if the mode of derivation is public or private or protected, it remains private. So it is not accessible irrespective of whether the mode of operation is, mode of derivation is public or protected or private. As simple as that. If the base class data members or base class member functions have access visibility specifier as public, and if the mode of derivation is public, they remain public to the derived class also. If the mode of derivation is private, then they become private members of the derived class, and if the mode of derivation is protected, they become protected members of the derived class. Okay. What if the base class members are protected and the mode of derivation is public? As I just said, those will still remain protected. They don't automatically become public members of the derived class. The protected members of the base class will remain protected members of the derived class even though the mode of derivation is public, and the protected members of the base class become private members of the derived class if the mode of derivation is private, and the protected members of the base class remain protected members of the derived class if the mode of derivation is protected. Is this clear? The three modes of derivation: public, private, and protected. Okay. We look at the second type of inheritance, that is multi-level inheritance. Okay. Here I have a base class, an intermediate base class, and a derived class. Such inheritance hierarchy is called multi-level inheritance. Okay. Where the subclass is called child class, the intermediate base class is called parent class, and the base class is called the grandparent class. Okay. So as you can see here, we have a base class A, class B derives class A, and class C in turn derives class B. Okay. That is how the multi-level inheritance is implemented. Okay. This is an example. Let us look at an example. I have base class person, an intermediate base class employee, and subclass or derived class programmer. Okay. Let us quickly look at a programming implementation. Okay. Base class person has members such as name, gender, and age. And it has functions like getData and display. Clear? Let us not look into the implementation details. Okay. What getData does, it reads the values for the data members of person class and displays the values contained in the data members of the person class. Okay. Class employee derives class person using public mode of derivation. Okay. Class employee derives class person. So all of these will be logically present. Will be logically present in employee class. However, employee class introduces its own data members like company and salary. And it also defines getData and display. Or rather, it redefines getData and display. Now, we have an interesting thing here. I have a getData function already defined in the base class, and the subclass employee is trying to redefine it. Okay. If I have more than one definition of a function with the same name, we call it as a function overloading. Whereas if a derived class defines or rather redefines a member function that is already defined in the base class, then that is called function overriding. Okay, understand the difference between the terms overloading and overriding. Okay, overriding comes in whenever we have inheritance hierarchy, whereas overloading comes in whenever I have two or more functions sharing the same name but having different parameter list or having different signatures. Okay, so employee is redefining get data and display, which are already defined in the base class person. Observe that I am invoking get data function defined in the person class using the scope resolution operator before I actually display the members of the derived class. That is, before I can display company and salary, I want to first invoke the base class function get data. So how do I invoke the base class function get data from the derived class? I have to use the scope resolution operator. Person colon colon get data, that is name of the class, scope resolution operator, derived member function. This will invoke the function get data contained in the class person. Okay. And then I have a programmer class which derives from programmer class which derives from employee class. So all these things will be logically present within programmer class also. Programmer class in turn defines its own data member called number of languages known, and it redefines get data and display. So when I instantiate an object of the subclass programmer, and when I invoke get data, it first invokes get data. This in turn invokes get data of the intermediate base class, which in turn first invokes get data of the base class, and then finally the remaining statements of get data will be executed. Same is the case for display. Okay, it demonstrates. I have the same class here, person class, and then employee class, which derives the person class, and the programmer class, which derives the employee class. And within main, I have instantiated an object of the derived class programmer, and then I invoke get data and display. Let us quickly build it and execute it. You can see the execution behavior. Enter data. Okay. Age, gender. The first three are captured by the base class members. That is, a name, age, and gender are captured by the person. Name of the company and salary, these two are captured by the intermediate base class employee, whereas number of programming languages known is captured by the derived class, that is programmer. And finally, the entire data is displayed, where the first three were displayed by the base class display function. Next two pieces of information, that is name of the company and salary, are displayed by the intermediate base class display function, and the number of programming languages known is displayed by the derived class or the subclass programmer. Okay. Is this clear as to how the multi-level inheritance works? Okay. Let us look at multiple inheritance, where I have more than one base class and a derived class. In this case, class C derives from both class A and class B. This is an example of multiple inheritance, where a class can inherit from more than one base class. Okay, it is typical, right? Okay, you inherit the properties of both your mother as well as father. Okay, by properties I don't mean the real estate, it means the attributes, okay, or the characteristics of both the mother and the father are captured by or daughter. That is an example of multiple inheritance, basically. Let us look at an example of multiple inheritance. Okay. Take a look at this. I have a class A which has one data member X and a member function which reads a value for X. Class B has one data member Y and a member function which reads a value for Y. And class C inherits from both A as well as B. And what does it do? It introduces its own member function called sum, which will in turn add the values contained in X and Y respectively. Where is X? X is available in class A, and C has access to it because it has derived from it. Y is a data member of class C, and class C can access Y because class C has inherited it from class B. Okay. Inside main, I instantiate an object of class C, and then I can invoke getX function on the object of class C, because getX function, though is defined in class A, but since C has inherited class A publicly, the function getX is available to an object of class C. Similarly, getY, which is a member function defined in class B, is available to class C because class C has inherited from class B the function getY. So an object of class C can have access to the member function getY. And sum obviously is a member function of class C, and hence object of class C does definitely have access to the member function sum. Okay, so this goes on to demonstrate that in case of multiple inheritance, one derived class can access members of more than one base class. Okay, now that may lead to ambiguities also. Okay, do you understand what I mean? Okay, if I have more than one base classes and a derived class inheriting from both the base classes, then it can lead to ambiguities. What kind of ambiguities am I talking about? Okay. Assume that I have class A that has a member function show, and I have another class that has a member function show. Understood the problem here? Okay. Both class A and class B have a member function having the same name. Okay. That is always possible in reality, because class A could have been implemented by some person and class B could have been implemented by some other person, and you are reusing. Inheritance leads to reusability. So it is always possible that two classes may have a function with the same name. Now, derived from both class A and class B, and inside main, if I instantiate an object of class C, try to show, there is a question mark. Why question mark? When I invoke show, should the function show contained in class A be invoked, or the function show contained in class B should be invoked? That's a big question, right? This is what we call ambiguity. Okay, and in such cases, your C++ compiler will immediately show you a compiler error saying that it cannot resolve this statement. This statement cannot be resolved because function show is contained within both A as well as B, and C is inheriting from both A and B. So compiler is not in a position to decide as to whether it should invoke show contained in base class A, or it should include the function show contained in base class B. This is the problem associated with multiple inheritance, and that is essentially the reason as to why the programming language called Java, okay, which you will be studying in the next semester, in the third semester you will be studying Java does not have multiple inheritance. Why Java doesn't support inheritance, they support multiple inheritance. If someone asks you this question, you should be in a position to understand and explain this peculiar problem that may arise when you are dealing with multiple inheritance. Okay. With this, we'll stop for the day, and the remaining concepts we'll be looking at in the next session. Okay.